Tonight we head out on the highway and take the nation to the station as we go by road and rail. Let's meet my fellow roadies off the beaten track. It's Callie Beaton. Travelling down a B road, it's Aisling B. On a driving holiday, it's Holly Walsh. A blue whale of a time, it's Alan Davis. And their buzzers are really raily. Kelly goes.
See it.
Ashley goes.
Say it.
Holly goes.
Sorted.
Alan goes. Oh, okay. So I think you're going to be needing this. So this, rather pleasingly, it is a rail replacement buzz service. How good is that?
That's very pleasing.
Yeah, I'll just back her up. Oh. Oh, Gary, do you want to be able to control it? No, that's a terrible idea. Isn't it great? Uh-oh. That cost $5.99, I'll have you know.
Thanks, Hal. Okay.
I love the fact it's called Topped Fig Transit, presumably because it's just about your size.
Yeah, wow. OK. Let's get the road on the show. In which country can you drive from East Coast to West Coast on Route 66?
Oh, no. Come on.
We're not going down there.
Everybody's done the show before.
Say
yes.
America.
America, yes. Yeah, you'd think, right?
Yeah, because it's the answer.
This is the wrong answer. Mm. OK, so we want to drive from coast to coast. There is only one country with a coast-to-coast route 66. Any thoughts where it might be? Yes, Callie.
Armenia.
Armenia. Weirdly, is not a klaxon, because we hadn't thought of it.
Australia.
Australia, no. France. Closer to home.
Ireland.
First person. No, closer
Scotland.
To home.
Scotland. England.
It's the UK. Yes, it
what?
Is the UK. Yeah.
What?
So the A66, which I'm sure you've all thought, let's take a driving holiday. it goes 115 miles coast to coast. It is from Middlesbrough in the east to Workington in the west. It passes through, actually, lovely places. Darlington, Keswick, Cockermouth. Sounds weird, doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah. Coming out of your mouth.
Out of my mouth. Rolls off the tongue, of course.
Isn't that what everybody does when they walk across England, that walk? Isn't that the walk?
I don't know if you do it on the A road, that would be a bit boring, would it not?
No, that makes it easier, surely.
You know the way in America people are always like, do you know what, let's give up our jobs and go on Route 66 and take a car and just discover ourselves. It doesn't feel like people would be going, like, from Darlington to Cockermouth.
Yeah. Finding remote jazz clubs. Counterculture. Experimenting with new drugs.
We've been to every Greggs along the A66.
It's not the same since they shut the little shed.
So the A66 in 2018 was named Motorway of the Year.
Oh. Mm. But it's an A-road.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes.
I wonder who would collect that. Like, who would go, oh, my God, it's me! I'm the A-road!
So, why might it suddenly be named Motorway of the Year, the A66?
Was it transitioning? Did it identify as a motorway?
Yes, weirdly.
Oh, that's it.
For one single mile, it identifies as a motorway.
Does it? That's all it takes.
It's A66 brackets M. For a single mile, and apparently in the great contest to be Motorway of the Year, that's enough.
Is it?
I know. The American Route 66, which we know about, it never ran coast to coast. Route 66 starts in Chicago, which is about 700 miles from the Atlantic, and then it travels through Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas, New Mexico and Arizona, all the way to Santa Monica in California.
I actually drove part of Route 66 with my children, and that is a lot of games of I Spy.
Yes.
I can tell you, it's a long way. But in Missouri, there's a fudge factory called Uranus. and they have, obviously, the usual welcome to Uranus, life's pretty sweet in Uranus. It's, yeah.
Oh, I need to go.
And then we got divorced a year later, but it was a nice...
You and the children?
Me and the children.
They're still in Uranus.
There are some fabulous things to see on the way. There's a wonderful ghost town in Oatman, Arizona, where you can still see one of the former brothels. It's called Fast Fanny's. There it is. Other attractions, the world's largest concrete totem pole. Who doesn't want to see that? And the world's... OK, I love this. The world's second largest rocking chair. Yeah. A tiny bit disappointing. So the one on the left says world's largest... It was. It no longer is. It's on Route 66. It's 42 feet tall. It's in Cuba, Missouri. The one on the right has outdone them. It's now in Casey, Illinois, 56 and a half feet tall. And one of the things, if you want to be the biggest rocking chair in the world, it has to actually be able to rock. But they now have had to cement them in because it's so bloody dangerous to have a rocking chair that big. there is a thing, Alan, that I discovered on the route that I think you would like, which is in Cartusa, Oklahoma. There was a guy whose wife collected miniatures of blue whales. He was a retired zookeeper called Hugh Davis. And for their wedding anniversary, he decided to make a blue whale that is 20 foot tall and 80 foot long.
Whoa.
Yeah.
For a wedding anniversary?
For a wedding anniversary present, yeah.
How disappointing.
I know. It took him nearly 3,000 hours to complete. Imagine the jobs he could have done around the house.
It's not a very elaborate man cave, isn't it? It's got an opening at the top.
Yeah.
You could jump off the side. It's got steps. I think it's marvellous.
Do you find that quite a beautiful anniversary present, then, if someone made that for you?
Well, I would, especially if I had my own personal lake.
Yeah. Route 66, it was almost Route 62. It doesn't have the same... It doesn't have the ring to it, does it?
No. You can't rhyme it with kicks, can you?
No.
You can rhyme it only with poo.
Yeah.
You called it Route 69. Although that would have gone from the top to the bottom and the back again.
The road was officially removed from the US highway system in 1985 and replaced by interstate highways. But there are signs up now that say historic route or state route, that kind of thing. You can follow it. It's actually worth doing. It is a fantastic route.
Do you reckon we could drive the bus all the way around the set?
Oh, I really, really...
Oh, my God.
Do you think it would go down the hill?
I think it would maybe...
Oh, I'd love to see it go down the hill!
We may need to catch it at the end.
Yeah.
Go, Callie. You can go get them.
Has it got the power to go up?
Go, give it some throttle.
Go on, Alan. Go up there.
Oh, look at that natural.
It's just briefly like the Italian job.
It's a single.
So many Route 66 road signs were stolen for souvenirs that in some places they painted the signs on the road instead. But what's the best way to stop people from stealing road signs?
Oh, I'm...
See it.
I'm from Dorset. North Dorset, 2 points. And there's...
I give out the points.
Well, I just didn't want to leave anything to chance. So I'm from Dorset, and there's a place called Shittington.
it's hilarious. It's actually called Shitterton, yes.
Shitterton, even, yes. And the local residents, so what they did was, because hilarious people kept stealing the sign that said...
There it is.
Oh, there you go, Shitterton. Oh. So they clubbed together, and instead of buying the people who were stealing the signs a life, they decided they would buy a big, heavy rock-formed sign so no one could steal it.
Yeah, it weighs a ton and a half, and so far it's not gone. And I have to say they've done the same in the Austrian town of Fucking. But what they've done in America, particularly in one particular county, Colesville, Maryland, they've started taking the vowels out of signs. So anything to do with drugs, for example. So there was a place called Stoner Drive, and that sign kept getting stolen. It now looks like this. They've just taken the vowels out, and it stops people taking. The other problem is mile markers that say 69 on them. Those kept getting stolen. They now say 68.9. just to keep them going. I tell you what, let's see how we are at road signs. Let's play What's That Sign?
What's That Sign?
OK, have a look at this first sign, and can you tell me what it is for?
Wobbly truck?
Wobbly trucks.
Is it toasters in use?
So they did a survey by Quick Fit. They surveyed 45,000 drivers. 26% could not identify this sign. 100% of you on the panel. Anybody in the audience, put your hand up if you think you know what this is. Yes, darling, with the beard.
Adverse camber?
It is adverse camber.
Oh, wow.
Wow, I bet you're fun. Oh, yes, that'll be adverse camber. Yeah, that will be.
That's his safe word.
Adverse camber!
Just look at the town in Dorset, doesn't it? Oh, she's living in adverse camber at the moment. try this one. What does this one mean? Anybody?
No waiting. Does it mean no waiting, sir? No. No, what's it mean?
Is that the Swedish flag?
No, the Swedish flag is blue and yellow.
I don't want to be shamed for just guessing, Sandy. I've failed my driving test twice now.
Right.
And every single time, the ones you don't need come up in the book, like, yeah. Oh, no, a pigeon's nearby or something like that. Like, what's the sign for that?
I passed my test so long ago, there wasn't a written.
Before pens.
Before pens.
Was it mostly just like, and the horse goes this way, and then around the side?
I was at school and we all made to take our driving test, and it was my 18th birthday, and as we pulled away from the driving test centre, a small child ran out into the road and I did an emergency stop, and the woman who was doing the test, she went, fucking hell, you can have your licence. Does literally nobody know where this is? Yes, a gentleman in the red shirt.
Clearway.
It is a Clearway, absolutely
same
right.
Thing. Same thing.
Well, it means no. You can't even stop and.
Yes, yes,
yes, that's what he said. No stopping.
No, you said no waiting.
Yeah!
He said no stopping.
Okay, you can't wait, you can't even stop.
No, you can't!
I'm going to give you an extra point so that you don't have a seizure.
You know, Alan's the first person to get road rage sitting in a studio.
In the survey, 33% of people could not identify this sign. It is indeed a Clearway. And the final one, let's have a look at this. Anybody know what this
is? Say.
Yes.
Is that one, don't take offence?
Don't take offence from the top of a barber's shop.
That is what it like. Anybody know what it identifies?
Is it to do with a level crossing?
It is to do with a level crossing. What do the bars below it mean?
I'm just trying to lip read the man in the audience who knows everything. His wife's having the best afternoon of her life. It must be nice to be out the house, is it? Yeah.
Hands up, anybody who knows what this one means.
I bet you whoever knows the next answer will have a white beard.
No stopping on the level crossing. No, is not.
You need a sign for that?
Yes.
Shall we? This seems like quite lucky to be parked so close to the station, actually. No, wait it!
There's a man over there.
Crossing in 200 yards.
Yeah, so it is. It's counting down the distance to the level crossing. Whoa. Very well done!
Oh, yeah.
Should have been christened the middle-aged white man round.
I know. That's just extraordinary.
You're living in a middle-aged white man world, my
friend. So there was an issue in the 1960s. There was a lack of consistency to UK road signs, and so they set up a commission, and the graphic designers Margaret Calvert and Jock Kinnear were commissioned to come up with the standardised signs. In fact, they were all designed by Margaret Calvert. The little girl is based on herself at school. The cow is actually based on a cow she knew called Patience, and she always hated the jokes that were made about her men at work sign. She says, because I drew the shovel going into a mound of earth, it looks a little like a man having difficulties with a very large umbrella. I just wish I'd left the tip on it to show it was a shovel. It'd
be quite funny if that was like her burying her husband and she was like, I'm going to use this for cash. I'm going to draw it later.
The first one was based on her leading her husband into the forest.
into his grave.
He's like, what? He's like, where are we going, darling? To see a cow.
But do you know why? Because he made her a blue whale for her anniversary.
From Rhodes in Britain to Rhodes in Greece, describe the pose of the Colossus of Rhodes.
See it.
It's a sort of a man spread, a sort of Tory. Like a sort of power stance, kind of that kind of thing.
Is it not there anymore?
It isn't there anymore, that is absolutely true. So we are trying to imagine what it would have looked like.
Oh, so every answer is right.
Except the one where it's astride the harbour.
I went to Rhodes once and they made a big play of this bloke used to stand across the harbour with his legs either side of the opening. So, you know, someone needs to tell them.
I know, it's a myth.
Ooh, that looks sore.
That does look uncomfortable. If the statue had been built over the harbour in that way, they would have had to close the harbour for 12 years, which, you know what construction's like. People going, oh, are you going to finish any day soon? Oh, wait, a little bit longer, get his leg.
Can't get his underwear on. We started it.
And then the statue, we do know, fell down in the earthquake of 225 BC, just 50 years after it was built. It was made of bronze sections. It had an iron and stone framework. It could not have been built with its legs apart. It would have absolutely collapsed under its own weight. There's also a clue in its name, Colossus. So Colossus was a particular type of statue that was found in Asia Minor, which always had its legs close together.
So it's like Angel of the North sort of thing.
Yeah, more like the Angel of the North, exactly right, yeah. In fact, the harbour straddling idea came from an Italian visitor called Nicola de Martoni.
Ooh, Sandy.
I know, right? Should I do the whole thing in Italian?
Yeah, yeah, do it, go on.
He said, the statue, the people told me, one foot on the wharf where the Church of St. Nicholas stands and the other end on the wharf where the windmills are. Thank you very much. Anyway, not only was his second-hand information, it was 1,500 years out of date, it's just, it stuck. There's that wonderful bit in Julius Caesar, why man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus, and we petty men walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonourable graves. I mean, it's beautiful, isn't it?
We've all been there, haven't we? Mm.
Yeah. The things you can quote and the things I can quote are just totally different.
Not like,
I'm not a girl, not yet a woman. Of course, as Britney Spears once sang in her hit, I'm not a girl, not yet a woman.
If you have a look at the modern attempt, so this is a design they have thought many times to try and do this.
Oh, lads.
That's very tasty.
If I saw that on a dating app, I'd be like, no personality. Come on, now.
Just go, what's in the bowl? What's in the bowl? £1 a guess, what's in the bowl?
It just looks like something that they would build in Dubai in about 5 years' time.
If you look just behind his left leg, you can see there's a third strut to actually hold it in place.
Oh, that is what
penis
that was.
Coming out the back. Yeah.
He's got an anal rod.
Yeah. Some fudge he bought at Uranus.
Why would that be a desirable thing for ships to go under? Like, that would be... Wouldn't you just be like...
I think it'd be more fun if it was a bit like a thing where you'd come towards it and the legs open as you...
Or his cock was like a massive rope swing.
It's possible we've gone too far.
Every morning went, whoa!
I'm moving on. Britain is home to the world's oldest working model railway. It was first built in 1912, but what was the point?
Was it so a 10-year-old Rod Stewart had something to play with on his birthday?
There is an astonishing railway that Rod Stewart has built. This, which looks like a proper railway station with all the buildings, this is Rod Stewart's model railway, and he has been working on it for 26 years. He's handcrafted all the buildings, and when he's on tour, he has a special room set aside where he can build his railway.
Isn't it funny that someone who puts out so much sexuality can destroy it all with something so...
it's good for the lady there with the road sign expert to know things could be worse.
Oh, I absolutely love model railways, and I have a little train that runs around the skirting boards in my office, but after I saw Rod Stewart's, I realised that mine needs a little bit of work. So this is Rod's, this is mine. Oh!
I love that. That's amazing. So does it go right the way around your room?
Yeah, around on the skirting board. I want to get a bridge at the door that'll open and close like that.
A bridge at the door?
Yeah, so that you could open the door and the bridge would go up like that.
You wouldn't have to have signs 20 metres before you get to the thing saying track approaching.
Exactly.
You know, no offence.
Yeah, exactly.
What about if you had a colossus with a swinging dick opening and shutting?
So let's go back to this particular railway, built in 1912.
Were they making a plan, designing something?
It is certainly to do with the plan. It was in use until 1995.
Was it a training device?
It was a training device. So at the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railways Signalling School at Victoria Station in Manchester, they used a model railway because you do not want to practice your signalling on an actual railway.
No.
No.
You wouldn't want to get the mistake there.
Did they have a model buffet car where they could practice saying no more cheese toasties after Milton Keynes?
Do you know what I miss? I miss British Rail fruitcake. That was nice.
What about the pre-buttered malted loaf?
Malted
loaf. A bit of a divider. Do you have an opinion about those?
I don't know what you're talking about.
You know the serene malted loaf?
It's a malted loaf. If you bought it, would still be good to eat in 50 years. So model trains are still used to train railway stuff. So TfL have a place called Ashfield House in Kensington, and the tube staff use...
Are model stupid. Look at them.
In the way.
It's behind you!
How to use the platform. What am I doing wrong here?
It's a mock-up of a tube station. It's called West Ashfield. It's on the third floor. Complete with tracks and signals and barriers and a train and so on. And they train 1,500 to 2,000 drivers and operational staff there every year. The very first model railway was built in 1859. It was built for the three-year-old son of Emperor Napoleon III. Le Monde reported... I should do this in French.
Oh, please do.
Sandy, take us on another journey.
Oh, la la. Oh, la la, the railway, built for the amusement of the Prince Imperial, is a real toy, as well as a masterpiece of mechanical science. Its track is in the shape of the figure eight, the wit, and the caricature of its tiny rails is reminiscent of surprising curves of the railway.
Moving on, what's the secret to catching the invisible rail?
I'm 50. I'll take your silence as stunned. That's fine.
But no!
No! Thank you.
What? OK, let's do it again. Everyone's going to say no. Ready? Go ahead.
So, I'm 50.
What?!
None taken. So, but there was a man who said that women at 50 are invisible.
Not to men who are 54.
No.
So I thought maybe it's a 50-year-old woman.
Well, certainly in a restaurant, that is true.
Yeah.
Have you tried popping one tit out and seeing if they can see there? Just the one. No need to come across as loose or fast. Listen.
At a certain age, Ashling, they just sort of fall out and drag with you. You've got to be very careful for
them
not
to... Oh, like you could pop it out under your
skirt. Yeah, anywhere you want.
You have to pop it out and then you have to go, oh, oh, oh! Oh, yeah, I'll have soup.
I'm going to ask again.
It's not the word for the overhead power cable, is it?
No, it isn't. In fact, we are being misleading with our illustration.
Oh, I think I know it. It's a bird.
It is a bird, you're absolutely right.
An invisible...
What's a bird?
Well,
rail.
So they're small, often rather dull-looking birds, frankly, but they live on the ground. They live in marshy areas in very, very difficult-to-reach
places. I mean, that one's dead. You know that one's dead?
No. No. So these are the largest of the flightless birds. So it's probably about this big.
Cousin of a chicken, perhaps, Sandy?
Chicken is definitely bigger than that.
I meant to say it's the smallest of the flightless birds. With you, I'm still stuck on your tit coming out from under your dress. It's the smallest of the flightless birds, and one of the most elusive is called the invisible rail, so-called because of its ability to hide in the long grass. There was a guy, a German biologist, called Gerd Heinrich, and he's the very first person to have caught an invisible rail, and he said, I am solidly confident no European has ever seen this rail alive, and that requires such a degree of toughening and such demands on oneself as I cannot so easily attribute to others. And he wasn't exaggerating, so he went to this Indonesian island called Halmahera, and there's terrible, dense, bug-ridden thorn wilderness, and in order to get himself ready and toughen himself up, he rolled naked in beds of nettles. So, I know, he was keen. He was very, very keen.
Just shouting, Adverse Camber!
He left his pants on. Well, you don't want a nettle sting on your, on your penis.
Yeah.
I mean, you might as well just keep everything else on and just roll your penis in the nettle. Once you've got one on your penis, you're not going to think about any of the other... Just sting your penis and leave your clothes on.
If I was there, I'd just swing one breast into the nettles and we'd all be happy. Swing it! We're not all 32 anymore.
Rails tend to live in places where human beings don't, because human beings bring dogs and rats and so on, so they tend to live in inaccessible places.
Sandy, have I missed a trick? Why did he roll in the nettles to catch the bird?
He wanted to toughen himself up.
So he wanted to toughen himself up because he was afraid of that bird?
No, it's the inhospitable terrain. I mean, it's a horrendous place because there are no human beings there.
Why didn't he just go to Lewisham?
Because there are no rails there.
There's a DLR.
Do you know what?
Quite well served the Court,
yeah, there's Lewis. The DLR, there's the...
I read everything to do with rails and not once did we come up with the question, why not just go to Lewisham? The smallest one of these is the Inaccessible Island Rail. Isn't that fantastic? Which lives on an inaccessible island, hence well-named.
Oh, my God.
28 miles southwest of Tristan da Cunha, middle of the South Atlantic. And you can only go for 1 week in the year.
What bit of a person is that?
Yeah, I wonder.
What are we comparing the size of this to?
I think it's a finger.
Hope it's a finger.
So do I.
Well, I think it's a finger.
Do you know what? In fairness, as dick pic goes, that's like a better one.
Bit with a tiny rare bird on it. About to go all the way to the South Atlantic. It's only 1 week of the year.
Okay.
Don't do anything for you.
All right. Yeah.
It's just for scale.
It's a giant eagle. Look at the size.
Now back to the railways. Tell me, who wouldn't be seen dead in first class?
Who wouldn't be caught dead? There's a clue in the question.
I dated a pilot for a bit, you know, an ex-Red Arrow, actually.
When you say you dated him for a bit of what, exactly?
Well, I...
Air miles?
I asked him once, I did say to him, will you,
Will you land?!
Yeah. When we were in a bit of a saucy situation, I said, will you do the, pilot's voice? Will you pretend you're landing the plane? And he said, where are we landing?
And he said, Brazil.
He didn't enter into the spirit of things at all. He started asking if we'd had clearance from the tower.
Oh, God!
But he said
to
me...
What's it got to do with
the
railway?
It has got something to do... Well, I just thought you'd like that image. And then,
This whole show has been a delight for me.
He said to me that they have cupboards for if people die in the plane, they put them in a holding area, because people do die in the air.
And they put them in a...
In a sort of, you know, where they might put your bags or your coat. They put cadavers. If someone dies in the air...
they put them in overhead lockers.
They have a... Not an... not overhead.
Can you imagine trying to stuff that, like...
That's impressive.
Whose bag is that?
I'm just trying to get
my bag.
So you get home and you're like, oh, I picked up a dead body, not my bag.
But we're talking about the railways. It was a specific railway that ran from Waterloo out to Brookwood in Surrey. Why would it do that? It's the largest cemetery in the whole of the UK.
Oh.
And there used to be the London Necropolis Railway. And it was built in the 1850s and it was to transport bodies out. They had a real problem with where they were going to put dead bodies.
I know, Surrey.
Yes, that's exactly. The churchyard of St Martin in the Fields was only 200 foot square, and yet it had 60,000 people in it, so they really...
What? Is that the one off Trafalgar Square?
Trafalgar Square,
is necro dead people?
Yes, it is
necro. I recognise that from another phrase.
Yes. So the trains had first, second and third class carriages for the dead. The main sell of the first one was that your loved dead person did not have to be anywhere near a lower class person as they left London. God. It was opened between 1854 and 1941, and estimated 203,000 people made that particular one-way trip.
In coffins?
Yes, so there was a hearse carriage, and then there was a mourner's carriage.
Hearst class?
Yeah, it was a hearse class. First and second class mourners had their own waiting room away from the third class, and then Anglicans and non-Anglicans had separate stations at the cemetery. And actors would always get off at the non-conformist stop because it was the only one that would perform funerals on a Sunday, and that's the only day that actors got the day off. And so they were buried in a special section on a Sunday. What I like is there was a licensed bar at Brookwood Station when you arrived, and there was a large sign that said, "Spirits served here."
I love that there was just a day for actors to have. That must have been the loudest day.
The Sunday.
Yeah. Yep. No! How can I make this about me?
Maybe I can have her part. Yeah. May 1876, the train was delayed because its driver, John Wilkinson, collapsed and died after climbing into the cab. It's not funny.
Chuck him in the back.
Yeah. Anyway, you can still see the entrance to the Necropolis Railway. If you have a look there, it's flats now, but that is the old entrance to the London Necropolis.
You said that was a Waterloo?
Yeah.
Wow.
Even in death, the second-class carriage was a place where nobody wanted to be.
Hey.
What did Charles Rolls and Henry Royce make together?
Was it sweet, sweet love? Oh.
They did make something together.
Was it Royce's Rolls, a famous sandwich shop?
Well, they make jet engines, don't they?
Yes, that they didn't actually make them together. I think the only thing they made together was money.
Oh.
That's it, really. So Charles Rolls is the one on the left. He was the car dealer. And Henry Royce, who is the one on the right, he is the one who made them, but they didn't make anything together whatsoever. So Royce, he made all sorts of domestic electrical fittings and dynamos and that kind of thing. And in 1901, he bought a French de Coville kind of car, and he thought, I could make a better car than this, and he started to make them. And Charles Rolls was a car dealer in Fulham, and he was very impressed with Royce's first car. And he agreed to take them all. And when you bought a Rolls-Royce, they only provided the chassis. You got the engine and the wheels and the chassis, and then you went to a carriage builder and got them to build the rest of the car for you.
I dated someone once. Oh,
God. And what sort of automobile did he drive?
He drove a Rolls-Royce Phantom.
And you were like, yeah, well, my last boyfriend was in the Red Arrow.
I was. So he told me that the upholstery is made out of bull hide, not cow hide, because cows get stretch marks during pregnancy. So even the cars are sexist, not just the drivers. They can't have the
cow.
That's
extraordinary. In fact, they don't make any cars at all now. They stopped making cars in the mid-'80s, and it's now owned by BMW. Rudyard Kipling had a Rolls-Royce Phantom, and the thing about... I know, great thing now.
We still know it's you, Rudyard.
That is an arse of
a
chin.
It does look extraordinary. Like, like with a baby's bottom attached to his chin. So, rather famously, Rolls-Royces never break down. They very occasionally fail to proceed. And in 1932, Rudyard Kipling had a Rolls-Royce Phantom and it failed to proceed, and he was in the south of France. And so he phoned the company's Paris office and he said, you know, you must send a mechanic. And noon the next day, he still hadn't heard anything, and he was quite cross, and he was going to send a complaint. He asked the hotel, and the manager replied, the gentleman from Rolls-Royce came last night, it was only a minor matter, and it turned out the mechanic had come in the middle of the night, fixed it, gone before sunrise, and didn't announce it because he didn't want to disturb Kipling's sleep.
They had a principle, didn't they, that no one would ever see a Rolls-Royce at the side of the road break down.
Well, more than 60% of the cars ever made by Rolls-Royce are still roadworthy. And now I'm afraid I'll have to railroad you onto the road to ruin that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Have you got your bell? What is the most expensive metal on Earth? Yes.
I didn't mean to do that, it just went off. The most expensive?
Yes, most expensive metal on Earth.
I don't know.
I'm going to give 5 points for absolute honesty. It's one of the noble metals. It is incredibly expensive because it is both useful and rare.
Foil.
Yes, foil is a noble metal. Rhodium is the answer. So, for example, gold at the moment costs about $50,000 a kilo. Platinum is about $27,000 a kilo. This costs $350,000.
That sounds like something that a rapper would get his teeth done in.
In rhodium, yeah. I mean, whether you could or not, I don't know. There's hardly any of it mined in the world. It's so expensive.
What's it used in?
Catalytic converters. About 80% of all rhodium is used in catalytic converters. The amount you'd have in a car, it's the same weight as about a quarter of what a postage stamp weighs, but it adds £70 to the price of your car.
So rather than nicking a car, all I need to do is prize it open, go through it and get the rhodium out.
That's what people do. Yeah. I had mine stolen.
What, just for the rhodium?
The catalytic converter out of a car. They pull up with a power tool, you go underneath it, cut it off, and they've gone in 2 minutes.
Yeah. And you're just driving along.
No. You're not in the car, you've parked it, yeah. You've gone about your business, and when you come back, your car's going.
Are they going to start making them into, like, rings for weddings and stuff like that?
Well, yes, darling, because it is in jewellery. So it's used especially as a plate for white gold. It gives that sort of reflective surface. Mm. So it is used in that. It's also used in heart pacemakers.
They get nicked all the time as well.
Yeah.
Going about your business, 20 seconds later, they've nicked your pacemaker.
But it's tiny. The average tonne of the Earth's crust contains about 0.001 grams of rhodium. So that's about the 30th of the weight of a grain of rice. In 2018, only about 22 tonnes was mined, which is the weight of a single anchor for a cruise ship. If you imagine it's used in virtually every car in the world now, you can see why the price is so high. But it's possibly it's not going to be a great investment because what's going to happen about catalytic converters? Do we think?
Everyone's going electric.
Everybody's going electric, so we won't need them anymore. But here's a really interesting problem with electric cars. Because they don't make much noise, pedestrians cannot hear them coming. So there is a new law that all cars have to make a significant noise. What noise do you think would be a good noise for a car to make?
Dukes of Hazzard.
Yes. I used to live near a strip joint in Hackney and they used to drive around with a kind of A-board at the back and it used to make orgasm noises.
Seriously?
Seriously, yeah.
It's nice they've got a picture of the car you took your driving test in.
Very good. It is a serious problem. Jaguar made a car that made a noise like a spaceship from a science fiction film. But what happened is as the car approached people from behind, they all went...
I was in a taxi in Dublin once, and when your man beeped the horn, instead of like a beep, it made the sound of horses going like that. But people didn't jump out of the way; they just sort of looked straight at the car, thinking it might be a horse.
See, I love this. So, what do you think would be a good sound?
An engine noise.
Just imagine some kind of engine. Yeah.
Like they put the sound of camera clicks on phones because people are stupid and they think it doesn't sound like a camera. It has to sound like a camera.
This is a serious issue because if you're going to have electric cars for police. Should they have a noise? Because sometimes they want to sneak up, don't they, on a burglar. So should you be able to turn it off if it's a police car? So sometimes it can go nanu, nanu, and sometimes it can go shh.
I'd have one that went ooh.
That's what I always thought about burglar alarms and stuff. If rather than sort of like, you know, it was just like a child's voice singing Ring a Ring of Roses or something like...
Oh, spooky.
This is creepy. Haunted. We need to get out of here.
The elves tell me making things look or sound older or more naturalistic than they are is called skeuomorphism.
Making things sound older than
they are. Sound older than they are. Yeah. So that idea of having a sort of an old-fashioned click or, you know, when some people have on their smartphone, they have the sound of an old-fashioned telephone ringing.
It's like, you know, people do wind down the window when really they should... on a car, they should do that. Or, like, cleaning your teeth. Like, that's the mind of cleaning your teeth. But everyone's got electric toothbrushes now, but this...
That's... Yeah.
I don't have an electric toothbrush, but all the kids want them. They are deafening and very irritating last minute.
Now, deafening?
Why is the car totally silent?
Yes.
The tiny little toothbrush goes, meee!
That's a question for the ages.
Yeah.
Right, moving on. These matches work thanks to a chemical reaction, which I'm sure you know involves phosphorus. But can you tell me where the phosphorus is?
Well, I presumed it's in the coloured tip at the end, but is it on the scratchy plate?
Are these they normal-sized matches, or are they...?
Yeah. So these are safety matches, and the phosphorus is actually on the side of the box. It also has some powdered glass in this strip, and it's the friction when the match strikes.
I was right, then.
You were right. Anybody know how you might make phosphorus, which is, of course, the really flammable bit?
Two twigs and dryness.
No, you just boil urine.
Of course.
Yeah, yeah. But don't, because it'll set fire.
If you boil urine, it'll set fire.
Well, it'll boil it down to the phosphorus, and then that is how it was discovered.
From someone who had bad cystitis.
No, it was discovered in 1669 by a German chemist who was boiling up some urine.
Why?
But he was an alchemist and he wanted to see what happened.
Yeah,
what
yeah,
happened
yeah.
was he discovered
No, he was an alcoholic.
There is a legend which I like that Swan Vesta, the famous match company, once saved thousands of pounds after a factory worker suggested that they put sandpaper only on one side of the matchbox, and that it was a suggestion scheme, and that they saved loads and loads of money by no longer putting the striking side on both.
It's like panel shows, they now put three women on it, just saves so much money.
I'm not going to say a word about it. How many terminals are there at Heathrow Airport?
See.
Well, I'm going to say five, and you're going to...
Alan, what do you reckon?
The three are on the airport itself. The other two are further away. Is that what it is?
No, it's that there are four. There is no Terminal 1.
There's a sign for
Yes.
It.
the sign is incorrect. Terminal 1 closed down in 2015 and all flights were diverted to Terminal 2. It was sort of sad, really, because when it opened in 1969, it was the biggest passenger terminal in the whole of Western Europe. And by the end, it was sort of tragic. There were, like, five shops and 20 planes. And they did it to expand Terminal 2, so there is no longer a Terminal
1. So when they're always on about building a third runway, they could just get the one out of one.
But a runway and a terminal.
Yeah, yeah, just do that. Has anybody here heard of Terminal 6 at Heathrow?
Oh, is that the one you run at and if you're a wizard, you get through?
Five and a half.
Yeah. Supposedly reserved for famous people, royals, heads of state and
Have you been in it, Sandy?
I have never. It is a posh lounge behind an unmarked door in Terminal
Sandy,
5, apparently.
When you fly, do you get whisked off? Like,
yeah.
Not with the normal people?
You have to pay. It's £2,750 plus VAT.
Could any of us get whisked for
Anybody could get whisked, anybody at all, as long as you've got the money.
So you pay that on top of your normal ticket?
Yeah. There's no shops there at all, but you know, big brands like Dior will bring stuff to you, and what I love is you get taken to the plane by a BMW.
So you have been whisked?
I've read and salivated. Right, let's look at the scores. Our winner today, leaving everyone in their dust with 9 points, is Holly! In second place, well, I'm not surprised, with 3 points, because it was an excellent contribution, the audience! Yeah. In third place, frankly failing to proceed, with minus nine, it's Alan!
That's not bad.
In fourth place, with minus 25, Aisling! And in last place, broken down on the hard shoulder with minus 30, it's Callie! Holly and Alan, and I leave you with this from one of the greatest motor racing drivers of all time, Juan Manuel Fangio. Driving fast on the track does not scare me. What scares me is when I drive on the highway, I get passed by some idiot who thinks he's Juan Manuel Fangio. Thank you and good night. We'll be right back.